So is that kind of okay with everybody? And so the last day we'll have, I'll have to check the calendar and I'll let you know next week, but we'll do it the last Wednesday that Black to be signed. So when would Black to be, if that's okay with everybody? I think it's the second.
It might be the 9th of June. Yeah, that's 9th in the batting order.
I'll get that exact date next week, okay?
My time just ended, June 10th, God takes off. Right.
But usually he takes off a little earlier in Arizona. We're pushing a little bit.
God's a snowbird.
Now, we can, if you guys want to still meet, we can do something. I mean, like last summer, Doug and Neil went to, the shepherd dog or,
that was great. It's from a sheepdog.
Sheepdog, yeah. So that's, that's still an option, Or if you want to lead something this summer, I would come down.
Don't say that to Howard.
I mean, Howard's great.
We have a restraining order against
him. Did you ever get a text or an email from Howard? I mean, they are wonderful.
I have notes.
Do you read all those notes? Okay, well, let's pray. Father, we just come to you today again and just thank you for this group. And Lord, again, we thank you for your sovereignty and know that there is nothing, absolutely nothing, small or large, that doesn't happen to us at first, doesn't go into your hands. And even though we don't agree with it, we don't understand it, we know that you have a plan, and we're thankful for that. And I just pray for everybody in this room and for their families, and just bless them, Lord, and wrap your arms of protection around them. And we just ask these things in your name. Amen. Okay, I gotta share something with you guys today. I've been transparent about so many other things in my life, so I decided I'm gonna bring this up also. My son Mark is an alcoholic. And he's had been in and out of some treatment centers for the last year, so he has been absolutely great. And we're building a shopping center together, and I mean, he's got talent, unbelievable talent. But he is really off the way. I mean, I had to fire him, and that's pretty hard for dad to do, but I had to do it. And he's not talking to me, and the texts I get are terrible. So I would just ask you guys, if you think about it, if you please pray for Mark, because it's getting pretty serious, and this has been going on for about 3 weeks now, and it doesn't seem to be getting better. He won't talk to anybody, nobody in the house, just one of those things. So I would appreciate it if you would. Thanks.
I thought you were going to extrapolate that more. I wasn't quite ready.
Okay, well, you're never quite ready.
All right. Remember to pray for Mark as the Spirit brings you to heart and to mind. So,
hey, Neil, let's pray for him right now.
Yeah. I might have been able to be going to maybe do that. Now I don't look as godly. So, and I'll do what other guys. Why don't you pray for him? Do you mind?
Sure. That would be great. Well, Lord God, Heavenly Father, we just lift up Mark and we ask that you put your hands on him and that you give him your wisdom and your guidance and even Dave as he is dealing with this issue. And we just pray that Mark might be restored to fullness and wholeness and that he might be able to again return to his relationship with his father and that he might have good years ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Appreciate it.
The baton, the Olympics now. Good news for those of you who are following our hockey team. Yes. We did win the championship last night. Woo! Yeah. And so that's exciting. And a beer league of a bunch of guys.
Yeah, you're on the bench the whole game?
You know, I'm just going to say, ouch. It's the 60s and 70s league. Yeah. And so, there's a Jeff Martin team right there.
Wow.
No, I'm not setting it up. It was Jeff. All right.
Hey, guys on Zoom land, good to have you with us. We tend to kind of, nice, everybody's waving. That's so great. Great to have you guys hanging out. And this has been a great way for us to kind of expand the reach, extend the time. Some of you are down in from far yonder, some even from Canada. And when they open up the borders, we might get across to visit family. So glad you guys are with us. Colossians chapter 1. We haven't been in this for a few weeks. We're really, what a blessing for the last couple of weeks to hear from John Lynch. I don't know, how many of you have read any of John's and Bruce McNichols and Billy Droll's material on True Face? You know, there's some really good stuff that they have done, and it's an amazing. And Skip, I can give a pitch for Del Tackett and some of his stuff that he's doing. If you're looking for a seriously good material, anything Del Tackett is doing out there is fantastic. In fact, Skip purchased a video on Genesis from your DVD that I gave to a guy in my hockey team who came up to me one time and said, hey, I'm studying the book of Genesis with a group of people. And I'm like, I didn't know if he was a Christian or not. He's not. I mean, they're not even believers. And his wife's friend said, hey, I'd love to meet, have dinner, and go through this book, Genesis. And so Skip was so kind to give a DVD, charge me for it, and he'll owe you. And every week he comes back and he says, I can't believe what happened in Genesis. Did you know that blankety blank blanks and turned to a pillar of salt and blankety blank blank? And it's just so wild to hear somebody who has no concept of Christ or the Bible get excited about the Bible. And so pray for his name, Warren. So. And I'm going to start calling them Skip, too, at some point. So so that's a lot of fun. I love getting out there. And there's some really good guys that would never step foot inside of a church. And so that's good. And when we prayed Colossians 1, we've been going through this book. And again, Paul, I love how Paul just takes things that are so complex. He was a Pharisee, remember, probably one of the most intelligent and powerful people of his day. He was probably like a megachurch pastor before he met God in Acts chapter 9 very dramatically, but a very, very powerful guy who would know a lot of things. And when he came to know Christ, one of the things he did was he took the scriptures that they would have and he helped people understand them. And one of the struggles, you know, that I have as a pastor and is when we take the scriptures and we elevate them to an academic strata that nobody can reach. Now, I love a good theological debate. I love studying doctrine. Dick has sent me a book called Talking Points from I was at Ligonier Ministries out there. I love reading that stuff. But if we can't take what these amazing truths and get them into our lives, we're struggling. We're going to struggle with that. We can't take it into our lives and then pour that into the lives of the people around us. Not so much the doctrine, but what it means to relate to a living God. We are not going to bear fruit that lasts. And at the beginning of Colossians, this is what Paul is talking about. He's commending the church, right? Because they have their faith in the right place. But then he commends them saying that your faith that's in the right place is manifested in action. You're loving the highway, the conduit, the language of whether or not you're getting this deep doctrine and theology is how am I doing in loving people more than I love myself. And it was grounded in their hope, their faith, their love, their hope. This was the Colossian church. And then Paul would go on and he would talk about how it's not so much about the mystical side of God, like what does God want me to do? People love to think about the future, right? Just like us, right? The book that's been studied the most since I've been here is the book of Revelation. I love Revelation. It says you're blessed if you read the book. But I think, if I was judgmental, most of the time we're reading because we're trying to figure stuff out, right? We want to know what's going on. We want to know. We want to be with confidence say that, you know, Saddam Hussein was the Antichrist. Well, you can't say that now. You got to make somebody else up on that one. But we love to talk about these things. And Paul says, you know, what's most important? Where are you in Christ? Where are you in your relationship? When Jesus says in John 15, 11 times, are you abiding in the vine? Are you staying close to me? The only work of a Christian is to stay close to the Lord and then get out of his way so that his work will move through you. That's hard to do in America because we like to measure. I want a report card. I want to know how am I doing.
And that's okay. That has a place. And Paul, in his letters that he writes, is saying our goal is to present people complete in Christ, mature in Christ. So I kind of want to know what that looks like. And what we get in Colossians is a good example of that, is we get a little bit of a blueprint of how do I know where I'm at in my walk with Christ and begin to let go the idea of, God, where do you want me to be? What do I do today? What do I do with my money? How do I, you know, be in Christ? That's most important. That's theology made simple. And then remember, we answer the question, what's God's will, right? God's will is simple too. In a basic sense, God's will is kind of what's in front of you. Who's in your sphere of influence? And it's not so much the what, it's the how. Those of us that are married, how are you doing marriage? How are you doing in that marriage? In your job, how you're handling your finances. The Bible has given us parameters, guidelines of how to handle finances, how to handle our time, how to handle relationships. How are we doing? That's God's will made simple. That's what we're going to be measured on. Did you take the resources that I've put into your life and did you use them to maximum potential, the parable of the talents? That's what God is going to come back. But so often we get caught up in trying to figure out the will of God. What is God's will? Let's pray. And that's okay. But let me tell you, you already know the will of God. It's right there. What's in front of you? And then that incredible passage, as you flow down chapter 1 here, you get to the whole preeminence of Christ, right? His supremacy in verses 15 all the way down to verse 23. All this whole idea of the gospel encapsulated in this incredible passage where Jesus tells us why he is God. He wasn't killed because he was a good guy. He wasn't killed because he tried to take over and be king. He was killed because he actually claimed he was God. And that was enough blasphemy for them to want to kill him. And then it forces every one of us to say, what are you going to do with Jesus? The gospel's pretty simple. There's a God that's not you, right? There's a problem where we have broken our relationship with God because of our sin. Jesus Christ came, lived a life that pointed all of us to the larger story, a life beyond this one, invites us to follow, tells us that our sin needs to be taken care of, and then lays his own life down as a sacrifice for that. Placing your faith and trust in that is what makes you a Christian, a disciple, a follower of him. It's the gospel made simple. Every one of us has to decide, what are we doing with that? And then we start to talk about ministry. Ministry is one of those words that we look at and go, well, that's what pastors are called to, ministry. And then we're the laity. Now, laity is not a word that ever came around until, I think, the modern day. There's no such thing as laity. When you place your faith and trust in Christ, you become a minister of the gospel. And ministry just means to serve, just means serving. And so the point is, and I filled it out in your outline a few weeks ago, was that if you're a Christian, you have a ministry. If you have placed your faith and trust, God has given you his spirit in you, which is really cool, by the way. And I was preaching at a church on Sunday from 1 Corinthians 3, where Paul was reminding them, and Peter does this too, that when you become a follower of Christ, he says that all the power of God is in you. That would be weird for early believers in a Hellenistic time to grasp, well, we get a mythological God out here, and we get, like the Romans, crafting idols that we can make and worship and control it. All of that in us, that would be a weird concept for them. 2,000 years later, we kind of get it. But here's the point. All of the power of the deity dwells in you and in me. I don't have a leg up on you. How many people say, well, the pastor prays, that's big, that's a big deal. Well, that is, if I pray, that is a big deal. You have the same power in you. And when we abdicate by shame or feeling like we're bound up in our sin or we feel like we don't know enough, we're giving Satan a leg up because all the power of the deity dwells in you at the same amount as it dwells in me. It's God's power. It's all right there. And we access God's power when we abide in him and get out of his way. And so when you become a Christian, now you have a ministry. And then your goal is to try to basically figure out what that is. So sometimes we call that calling, which is another mystery, right? We go, well, I don't know what the will of God is. Let me pray and fast and look at the tea leaves. Well, don't look at the tea leaves. And then what's my calling? And they make it really mystical. God's will is simple. It's what's in front of you. It's how you're doing life more than, you know, than what you're doing. And then God's calling is once you place your faith and trust, you are now called. You're called by God to live out your life for him. And the effort is to try to figure out what is the role that God has given me to do. So we have things like spiritual gift assessments. You can go on our SBC website, and there's a free spiritual gift assessment that you can do. Just to kind of, it's just a tool to help you figure out where do my gifts lie. You can take the Rick Warren approach. If you want to figure out your spiritual gifts, just try things. And if it doesn't bring life to you, or you feel like you're fumbling all over yourself, maybe that's not your spiritual gift. Or as you try something and you find out, man, this is really good. I love working behind the scenes and serving people and all that. I love encouraging and writing notes to people. You might have the gift of encouragement. Whatever it might be, try different things to figure out how you're wired. There's lots of different assessments. There's a real popular one out right now that's actually re-popularized called the Enneagram. Has anybody ever heard that? It's a really, you can go online and get free. I was afraid of it at first because it sounded like pentagram to me. And so, and it actually kind of looks like it if you look at the sheet of the assessment tool. But it really is a nice, again, a tool, not a rule. Help you get who you are. And if I were to ask how many of you raise your hands, know what your spiritual gift is, my guess is not a lot of us do, or your gifting. And where are you gifted? Or what are some of your strengths? What are some of those tools to tell you about who you are? It might be a good idea to try those things, because that might help you find what's my swim lane when it comes to figure out what my ministry is with God. And so ministry is finding a role in fulfilling for the Lord. So let's read Colossians 1, 24 to chapter 2, verse 3. And then what I want to pull out of that, we started a few weeks ago pulling up five things that I believe it will help you. Remember Paul saying that he's commissioning the Colossian church. He's saying that you might bear fruit. He wants God to be fully known to them, but that they might bear fruit that's lasting, bear fruit that grows. When you bear good fruit, it bears more good fruit, right? That's the kind of fruit that Paul wants the Colossian believers to bear, and it's the same with us. So I think that we're looking at about five things. We've got to two of them. We'll quickly review them and get to our last three and then chat. And feel free to jump in. I feel a lack of confidence every time I open the Word of God. And I also pray that just His Spirit will teach us what we need to hear this morning, just as Dave prayed for us. So Colossians 1, verse 24 begins like this. Paul says that now I rejoice in my sufferings. I want you to take that phrase and cross it out, because that doesn't make any sense. Block it out. I'm just kidding. Jeff's actually doing it in the Bible. No, but that's a weird thing, right? He's crossing it out on the screen. I rejoice in my suffering. Bizarre phrase, right? I don't like to suffer. And he says, for your sake. He's suffering for other people. It's bad enough for me to suffer on my own, but to suffer for your sorry soul? That goes against common sense, right? But Paul is, there's something for us in here. He goes on, he says, and in my flesh, I'm filling up what is lacking. Remember we talked about that, that we're not in heaven yet. We're still in a fallen place. And so we are now the light, the truth, amidst this fallen world that we're in, but our salvation is not fully realized. So Paul is talking about that. It's what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is the church, of which I became a minister, or the NIV would use the word servant, according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known. There's some clues in there that Paul's goal is to make the word of God fully known. The mystery, hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. Remember that word mystery in America means something different than it would have meant at the time of the Greeks, at the time the Bible was written. For us, a mystery is Agatha Christie, right? We open the novel and we have no clue what's going on, and there's this great mystery. But in the times that the Bible were written, a mystery was what was not known then, but is not known now. So they would understand this mystery, which is God in us, gospel for the Gentiles, this mystery that Paul talks about often in his writing. It was hidden for ages, now revealed to his saints, verse 27. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles, which Jews would not like this at all, right? In fact, they love to refer to Gentiles as what? Remember? Pigs, the most unclean animal you can think of.
pigs. Isn't it like that? Because our culture is always the same. We also, when we're mad, we try to think, what's the worst thing we could possibly say to somebody? My wife runs our kids' ministries here on the Shea campus, and she told me a few weeks ago a bunch of young boys were playing a carpet ball and throwing things around, and that's all they're doing. They're just playing carpet ball and messing around, and one kid got mad, and he's like, you racist, right? She's like, what does it have to do with anything? But I think he had heard the word. It was a buzzword in 2021. He thought, that's the worst thing I can say to you right now. I'm going to say, and no, we don't change. We're sinful people. We're going to look for the worst things that we could possibly say. I find it sort of humorous that, you know, when we use the term special needs, you know, when referring to people, we keep changing it every 2 years because people will use that as the bad word. They want to say the worst thing, but it's whatever you change it to, that's going to become the new word. And so because we're sinners, we're sinful people. And that's Gentile pig for the Jews was about the worst thing they could come up with, something so unclean. And they did not want the mystery. They did not want the gospel to leave them. They had a pretty good thing going. They thought they were God's chosen people. And how could we dare share this with anybody else? So it's this gospel to the Gentiles, these riches of the glory, this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Verse 28, and we proclaim, warning everyone, and I lost my battery, but let me change it real quick. Keep reading ahead of me.
Okay.
This is horrible. You don't even need this half the time, but I just like speaking to the microphone because I never got enough time with my Mr. Microphone.
That was a
three batteries at Scottsdale Bible Church. Who'd have thought?
Wasting the good Lord's money on batteries. What are we doing here? Incredible stuff. Okay. Let's see if it works. I hope it does.
Oh, my back. Sorry, you lost my game.
Verse 28, did we proclaim warning everyone and teaching? Warning everyone and teaching. So those words warning and teaching might want to highlight because we're going to come back to those. With all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Underline that phrase. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy, not mine, that he powerfully works within me. Another great phrase. For I want you to know, chapter 2, verse 1, how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen me face to face. A hint that Paul has never been to this church. Verse 2, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all of the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ. He keeps revealing the mystery, right? In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So again, highlighting just a few things from here. One of the first things that we talk of, the five things, if you're taking an outline, I filled in, I think, the first two for you. And that is, if you want to live a life that bears fruit, if you want to live a life that has eternal impacts, I think there are some really good clues. You might find some other things, and maybe we can talk about that at the end, that you can pull from this passage that Paul definitely had. Kind of goes against the grain of how we live or measure in America, right? We always measure by how many, right? So churches are always like, oh, we had so many people in our church, right? But when Jesus died, there was just a small group of people hiding in a room behind a locked door, right? When Paul, whenever he preached, he'd get beat up, thrown out of the city, left for dead. And yet he kept saying, man, this life is good. God is opening up doors. I'm like, what is it about Jesus and what is it about Paul that leads him to define success very differently than we do in America? That makes sense? And we have a very different way, and we'll talk a little bit about our metrics. But if you want to live a life that bears fruit, you have all the power of the deity in you, Ken, you, Don, and Phil, and Harry, just as much in me. It's all the same. And so if you want to see that grow, the seeds germinate in your heart and your soul, we get some clues here. Here's the first one on your outline, and that's having the right perspective. We talked about that a few weeks ago, the right perspective. And the perspective is, part of it is to stop making Christianity about you. That's tough. It's really hard because I like to make it about me. You know, and you come to a church like this, we build a beautiful campus. Every time I drive by this place, I'd sit there and go, wow, what an amazing church. And I'm like, and I get to serve there. You know, it's an amazing place. There are some incredible things that happen here. So, and you just hardly know much of it. Mark, you're involved in our cafe,
right? You know, so we have amazing food there, right? Right? So we have incredible teaching.
And it's on sale today.
And it's on sale today. Just the green bread is on sale today. So it's really cheap out there. So we'll see Penny about that. But the more we can meditate on the idea that coming to church, it's not about me, right? And yet I make it about me. The moment you complain about something, again, there's nothing wrong with giving influence or saying, hey, here's a thought or an idea. But when I find myself struggling with the music or the preaching or the temperature or the way the church is set up, I'm kind of making it about me, right? Again, we want to have the best expression of worship we possibly can, the greatest ministries. So nothing wrong with jumping in, rolling up your sleeves and helping advance the ball down the field. But ministry is not about you. I mean, you have the right perspective. As Paul said, ministry is about others. That's why right over the gate here in verse 24 of chapter 1, Paul talks about suffering. That when it comes to ministering, if you want to have fruit, now you can have fruit that doesn't grow and you can just keep coming to church for your life. But Paul uses that whole idea of ministry, serving and suffering. They go together. And like most of the time that you serve, you're not going to get back what you give. And I've seen so many people drop out of, you know, serving in the church because they felt underappreciated. And I've said this before, I'm lousy at appreciating people. I do need to work on that. Just ask Bill. Bill runs our seniors ministry at this church, Bill Heitzinger. He's an amazing, amazing guy. He's gone to seminary. He's got a ministerial license. Runs our seniors ministry. And I run Bill into the ground, right? How many times I don't thank Bill. I don't pay Bill. I don't do anything for Bill other than say do more so that I can do less. And he does it. And he does it out of love. And he does it because he understands that when you serve and you want fruit that lasts, you're going to give far more than you're going to get. Again, keep using Bill. His company is failing miserably. He's losing money. He's getting sick on this. Bill started he's one of our missionaries to the capital called the Capital Commission. And he's got to raise funds in addition to running our seniors ministry. He's trying to get into the legislature. They keep booting him out, kind of like Paul in the synagogue. He gets up off the mat. He goes back in. And he's enduring, he's persevering. I hope it's not embarrassing. Do you want to step out for a minute? But that's fruit. That's going to be bearing fruit that lasts. Because I said to Bill, man, a weaker man or another man would just give up. But he keeps going. He keeps persevering. Talk to Bill about how to have fruit that lasts. Suffering and serving are part of the deal that we sign up for. And we need to understand that when it comes to serving. So many people love to serve until somebody treats you as a servant, right? We're talking about that. Like, wait a minute, I don't want to be treated as a servant. Or it's really hard, in honesty, right? This is my, I look around, I see other people getting, you know, praise or advancement, and you're kind of left in the dust. It really brings out some ugliness in you. You're like, wait a minute, I want to get praise too. And so that's something to take to the Lord and confess, right? Just confess. Every day, Jerry's been teaching me that life is just about confessing every hour. Confess, repent, confess, repent, confess, repent. Because life has a way of bringing out the ugliness. And that's a good thing. That's the purpose. That's, if you're thinking about a field that needs to be tilled and soil, God's going to do that in you. But suffering and serving are part of that whole deal. And if you want to have fruit that lasts, you got to have that perspective. The second thing under outline was the right message. This is a big deal because I think we get off message. I was listening to an illustration from a guy yesterday on staying on, the whole concept of staying on message. It was a political podcast thing. It's like, you know, when you listen to a debate, right, that's why the person who's debating, you ask them, hey, how's the weather in Houston where you came from? And they're like, well, that's a great question. Let me talk about taxes and why we need to make sure they're not raised. And he goes off and he talks about whatever he's going to talk about, right? You see it all the time. We laugh about that when we watch the debates or we watch it. It's because they are staying on message, right? And so often a debate is to knock somebody off message. But we have an enemy in this world, the three-headed dragon of my flesh, the world, and Satan, who's constantly trying to knock us off message, off point, all that kind of stuff. So we need to continue to remember that our message has to be right. Paul says we want God to be fully known. That's the message, that people would understand who God is. But so often we veer off course. It's easy to do that. We talked about a couple of examples. My temptation when I meet somebody, especially playing hockey right now with a bunch of incredible heathens and pagans, right, is to want to clean up their life, right? If you want to come to know Jesus, you got to clean up your language. And again, that's getting off course, because if you start living like a Christian, if we send that message, you got to live like a Christian to be a Christian, you're not preaching the gospel. What's the gospel message? What does Jesus say? Come. Just as you are. Come as you are. And who changes you?
He does.
He does the work of changing. And so often, and it was Jerry that coined that phrase 8 years ago, and we say it all the time. So often we think if it's going to be, it's up to me, right? We got to do something. You know, our hair's on fire. That's exactly what the enemy wants. He wants you to be upset by the pandemic. He wants you to be angry about politics. He wants you to be mad at your church. He loves to divide from within.
Amen.
That's how he works. And if you want to have fruit that lasts, you need to stay on the message. Come. Are you an inviting person? Does your life spark curiosity in people because you're living differently? I was, and I told you, I walked in when this pandemic started into a Safeway. I'm like, I'm not wearing my mask because I'm a tough guy, and I don't care. And Jerry goes, you ever think that maybe somebody else might be a little nervous because you have your mask on? Okay, I'll put my mask on. You know, I'm going to get toilet paper because I might need some toilet paper. Then Ramona says, well, I'm getting toilet paper because my neighbors might need some. I'm like, revealing the ugliness of my heart and the motivations that are very selfish. And it starts. So we think sometimes we get off message and I want to clean people out. We get off message with the whole cultural thing, right? Like, how many of you think, man, our country's going to hell in a handbasket, right? Now, I want you to go home. If you think that, which you're probably not too far off, go study Rome around the time of Christ, right? Doesn't take much. Go look at some of the Old Testaments when they were worshiping Molech, and they would throw babies up, and it's horrific, and catch them on their spears. No big deal. If you had a baby in the time, Roman times that was born with a defect or a sex that you didn't like, you just took the life of the baby, and you were allowed. That was right under the law. Under the law. And so not to diminish that and make our country feel like we're a convent, but just to the idea is we're not, our job is not to clean up culture. Do we get that?
Amen.
Now vote, get up and volunteer. Those are all great things to do. But at the end of the day, our goal is to be a ready vessel by God to redeem lives, because Jesus came to redeem people, not culture, right? Stay on message. It's about people. And if you look at the early disciples, they went out. And what did they do? They went to people. They loved them. They cared for them. There was healing and miracles taking place, but it's about winning people to Christ. And when you win people to Christ, and it happens over and over, what happens to a culture? And Rome was turned upside down, right? But it was never because they protested, got out there to get everybody to challenge people to vote, got on their social media pages, whatever it would back then, or their social media, chisels and all that kind of stuff, you know, like the Ten Commandments. And so that would be really hard to keep up with your social media page if you had to chisel it into stone. So don't veer off course. Work your life that the people that are in front of you come before those people and try to love them to Jesus Christ. And so staying on message is really important. Third point, I think this is a blank now, so we'll try to fly through these in the time we have left. So we want to make sure that we have the right perspective and that we have the right message if we want to bear fruit that lasts. And the third thought is we'll make sure the right methods. Methods always change, but message doesn't want to. In verse 28, Paul says, in him we proclaim. And I had to circle the word warning and teaching. Maybe even underline the word and. Because I think the NIV uses the word admonish. So part of Paul's method was to admonish people. That means there are times in your life where you're going to see people going the wrong way, and you need to stop them. I remember my son Jesse was very little. He was about 4 years old, and we lived on a very busy street. And my wife had just gotten home. She'd been away for a couple of days, and he saw her talking to a neighbor across the street. You can imagine where that's going, right? And he just beelined for his mom. And I was talking to another neighbor on this side of the street, and he just reached out, grabbed my son's arm, and whipped him around, and kept him from right when a Corvette went flying by. right? And my son didn't understand. He was so upset by that. But that wasn't a time to say, hey, before you cross the street, let's talk about cars and speed and physics. That wasn't a time to do that. It was a time to admonish, to warn, stop. And there's a time in your life where you're going to see the people in your sphere of influence that need a warn. They need to be warned on that. They need to be instructed on that. But the other thing is that balances it is teaching. What's the idea? Teaching is that idea of coming alongside someone, isn't it? A good teacher is going to be able to pass on the elements or the things they want to teach to their students so that they grasp it. That's teaching. I remember taking a math class in college, and I still remember Mr. Robkin, Dr. Robkin. He would stand up there on the board like this, and he would just start doing a big, long equations in calculus. Remember that? And he would just write them on the board, and then he'd turn around and say, you got that? Right? And all the smarty pants were like, yeah, we got it, no problem. I'm like, I have no clue where you're going. And this went on for days. He's like, okay, here's the next one, because it builds on each other. I'm like, no, go back. I don't have the next one. You know, it was Dr. Robkin. I'll never forget a week into the class, door opens up and the dean of the college comes in and says, hey, this class is too big, and we need some people to volunteer to go to another class. I'm like, I go to this next class, and the teacher, I don't remember his last name. He goes, my name's Harry, and why don't you call me Harry? I'm like, thank you, Harry. He called me Harry, and he taught us calculus. I finished that class with an A. I understood, now don't test me now, but I knew calculus at the end of that class because Harry was a teacher. Dr. Robkin was a mathematician, right? So teaching is the idea of coming alongside someone. But here's the deal. When it comes to bearing fruit that lasts in your life, you need both, right? We've all been in it. If you're just loving the instruct side, you love to come alongside people and say, hey, we just want you to judge not lest you be judged. We take things like that out of context. We never want to be discouraging. We want people to get it. We want people to cheer them on. Here's a bookmark with a verse on it. Good job, Howard, for writing so many things for so long and sending them out to people. Just teasing it. And if we did just that, right, it would be tough because people need to be warned at times, right? So there would be people that would really struggle because there are times when we need to be admonished about things. Or if you're just admonishing, there would be people that are just all about warning. I remember when I was in college in Chicago at Moody Bible Institute, and I was on a hot date with a gal named Karen. I'd later marry her. We were walking downtown on Rush Street in downtown Chicago and enjoying the city and the lights. And we came upon a place where there was a bunch of guys gathered around. They all had three-piece suits on, and they were standing on, literally standing, I don't know how they did it, balancing on a fire hydrant, you know. And as people were passing by, they were just yelling at them, you are going to burn in hell. Sir, do you get that? Do you get that? You're going to die. You know what's in hell? There are worms in hell. They're going to come out of your guts, you know, and then you've got to stop right now, get on your knees and pray to receive Jesus. And I walked up to the guy, and I had no clue about that whole admonished kind of ministries where people just yell at you. I was like, whoa, this guy's a Christian. I walked up and said, hey, I'm a believer. He goes, how do you know you're a believer? You could be going. I'm like, I thought we're going to have fellowship. And I said, so I just bought him. I go to Moody over here. Yeah, it's a church. That's a school that's going to hell. I'm like, okay. So we walked on. How many of you have ever seen people come to know Christ in those ministries, right? Not too often. What happens most of the time? Most of the time, people make fun of those people. And we all get painted with the same brush. They ridicule people like that. And they're making a mockery, even though for them, I think they're doing it sincerely, but they're not bearing fruit that's going to last. Are there times we need to warn and admonish people? Absolutely. Talk about that. Warn. But balance it out with teaching, right? We want to come and instruct people. So we have to have the right methods. Every now and again, you see that with Jesus. You see that with Paul. They go off. You ever see them go off in Scripture? And I'm like, yeah, go for it, right? But who are they going off on? The pastors. Jesus would get in the face of the Pharisees, would be the modern day leaders of that time. And it wasn't because they knew too much Bible or they were too disciplined. They had that stuff down. And we still do. We come up to seminaries here, and I love our seminary. I think theology and doctrine are so foundational. They're so important. But people come out and they love to laud their knowledge, right? And then real life happens and brings us all back, which is a good thing. Jesus didn't get in the face of the Pharisees for because they knew too much or because they were living the Christian life perfectly. He got in their faces because they were judging and they were raising the bar so that other people couldn't get into the kingdom of heaven. He got in their faces because they were oppressing the poor, because they were just judging people. They had the books of the law, but the Jewish leaders added like 600 more laws just so we could be even better with God. That's a good definition of legalism, and that's what they're doing. And Jesus had a problem with that. Paul had a problem with that after he left that. And we can have this tendency, too, when we try to help people. Our tendency at times is that we can use methods to try to manipulate, cajole, debate somebody into the kingdom, or try to get them, like, I remember there, I felt so much pressure to win 3 in 83, you know, and I just had my 3 people on my most wanted list to pray for. Again, nothing wrong with that. But the pressure every time I went into the coffee shop was to be able to draw the gospel on a napkin and 3 easy points, get them to sign it, pray, and go, woohoo! Somebody just came to know the Lord, right? But again, we need to be very, very careful. Our job is to make the bar as low as possible. Not bring theology down, right? Remember I talked about how in our culture, when we're all immoral, God's standard never changes. But our culture just moves the bar down, and now we're all above the line again. That's called depravity. And then it'll just keep going down and down to the lowest common denominator. But God has called us to a higher standard. But our job is to not add anything to that. To remind the people in your sphere of influence, if you want to have fruit that lasts, God invites you to come. My friend Warren, we gave him a DVD on Genesis. I didn't say to him, hey, I want to make sure, are you a young earth guy or an old earth guy?
We didn't talk about that.
Do you think the literal 7 days? Do you think you believe in theistic evolution? Where are you with all that? I'm not even going there. He's just... you know, rhyming off all these curse words. Like, I can't believe God's effing cool, man. He's a man. Like, yeah, he's that. But God will change that. He's coming as he is. And we're trying to keep the bar as low as possible. Come as you are, let God change you. And that's tough for me. I guess it's tough for some of you, right? Because I want to help the chicken hatch by peeling the egg back. I want to help the caterpillar get out of the cocoon and before it's time. But God has a purpose in people coming and he doing the work of transformation. So we got to have that right, you know, the right perspective, the right message, and even the right methods. And I think Paul gives us some good things. Warning and teaching, they go hand in hand in our lives. Here's a fourth one, would be the right goals. I mentioned that earlier. Verse 28-29 kind of goes along the right message, but Paul says this in verse 20. He says, him we proclaim, verse 28, chapter 1, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Or this I toil with all his energy that he powerfully works within me. What's Paul's goal? Present everyone mature in Christ. What does that mean? That means this word teleos in the Greek. There was a friend of mine in California said, so we changed the name of our church to teleos. I'm like, really? That just sounds cool, a teleos church. Then I looked it up in the Strong's Concordance. You know what it means? Some of you know what it means. Perfect. What'd you say? Purpose. In one of the definitions is perfect. And I like that one because I would tease my friend Jim. And so your church is the perfect church, huh? No, we're going to call you perfect church. Nice. And but teleos has an idea of this doctrine, purpose, beauty, all those kinds of things. And this idea of maturing and giving a life of purpose. Paul's goal was to help you fulfill your purpose, right? That was Paul's goal in life. And Paul says, I'm not going to stop warning. I'm not going to stop teaching until people come to full maturity. As I looked at this verse, sometimes I kept thinking, what a great life verse, right? What a great verse. And it's just so full. It says in verse 28, have the guts to say the hard thing when you need to. Timing's important with admonishing, by the way, right? Sometimes we like to admonish people already. But as you're walking with the Lord, abiding in him, God opens up the doors for the timing of your mind. What a great verse. Have the guts to say the hard thing, what it needs to be said, and then have the wisdom and helpfulness to help people understand what to do with that once they've been admonished, once they've been taught. How do you help people understand that? We might call that discipleship. And here's the idea. Don't quit until people learn to live it out on their own. One of the things that I get criticized for often as a pastor is the fact that I'll spend too much time with people, right? And I'm kind of proud of that in one sense. I know there's a time to get off the horse if it's dead, right? But I don't think God gave up on people. There are some people in my life that come to know the Lord, and they are just so hungry. And they are so excited just to know God.
They basically just take off on their own, right?
And there are some people, it's like, man, they can never get the first stroke in the pool going, right?
There are some people that I've been meeting with. There's one friend I meet with, I've been meeting every Sunday morning for 5 years. He's in the same place. But you know what? I love him. And you know what? It's God's deal to change a heart, not mine. And I'm not going to give up. Because like Paul, I want my goal to be present everyone mature in Christ. Present them, or Paul would say, complete in Christ. And so when it comes to the goal, I think there's two big mistakes we make here. We often get caught up. One we've already kind of hit on a little bit. And I think the first mistake that I make, and maybe you're like this, is that we try rather than to help them mature in Christ, right? Warn, admonish, and teach people, stay with them, persevere, get in the messiness of their lives, love them unconditionally, right? It was really hard for me. My son, who's not living for the Lord, began to get interested in spiritual things again. I was like, yahoo! And then he started reading Rob Bell. Some of you know Rob Bell, right? And
what's that? He's bad news.
Remember, God loves Rob Bell, Don, so take that back right now. Right? And God is patient with Rob Bell. He was a great influence in the 90s.
Yeah.
He's got in-laws to go to Scottsdale. He went to Scottsdale Bible Church at one point. He had a church up in Michigan. He did the NUMA videos that every youth group had on the Spirit and how to walk with God. It was incredible, but went through a dark time and never really came out of it. Now it's gone more towards a new age kind of thing. But you know, my son started reading Rob Bell stuff. And I'm like, Jerry, my son's reading Rob Bell. What should I do? He's like, nothing, right? God's got him. God loves my son. And we've had great conversations when he talks about what he's learning in these books, or he's listening to some other things. I'm like, that's a little off. Because what I want to do, this is the first mistake we made, is I want to improve people's morality and living conditions. I want to fix everything. And I spent 25 of my 33 years as a pastor trying to fix people. You know what that did? Broke me, right? It just made me need to be fixed. And then as Jerry told me, God's got to go back and fix all the fixes you tried to fix. And he's right. And so I get off of the goal and I start to improve morality or make people more comfortable. I'm missing the point. Our goal needs to be helping people to live with an eternal perspective. So my son Alex starts to think eternally in the living God, that I start to trust his sovereignty, and he actually loves my son more than me. And maybe he's using my son to help fix my sorry life. That perspective has revolutionized my relationship to my son. We have a great relationship. I'm not trying to manipulate him back to church. And it's a mistake sometimes. But my goal is to help present him mature in Christ, to see Christ, to see that I have an authentic walk with God, not a perfect walk with God, and turn to him. I put down there Mark 8:36. I do love that verse. It says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world but forfeit his soul? You fix somebody. In our tendency, even as a church, I used to be in charge of our whole elder fund. They took that out of my hands pretty fast, right? Hey, we got a checkbook, and we got offshore Cayman Islands over here that we're helping. Howard's got 7 different names and pseudonyms for all the help that we're giving him. There are people that try to do that. And we love to help people financially, and that's a good thing. There's nothing wrong with giving food to people, helping people. But if that's all you do, you know, you've helped them gain the world, but where's their soul? If we go out and solve world hunger, you're just sending people to hell that aren't hungry, right? And so we've got to have a perspective on the eternal and help people see that as well. And always be working. The work again of us, you want to have fruit that bears fruit for eternity or that's lasting, is to keep abiding in Christ. And then the phrase that's been coming to mind is, for me personally, being a readied vessel. I like that. That God, every day when I go, that God's just trying to position me. He's trying to have me be ready. It's like the football coach when I was in high school said, you better be standing on that line right there with your helmet hand ready to go in, because when we call your name, boom, you're in. And I saw a lot of people's name get called. They're screwing around on the sideline. They never win the game. Be ready all the time to be in the game. So the right goals. So it's one mistake is we try to improve people's morality. I think the second one that we mistake, and this is, and I put that one in your outline just so hard, confusing a decision with the disciple. Sometimes we make Christianity about the transaction, get people across the line. And is it good that people come to the Lord? Absolutely. That's, you know, that's awesome. But sometimes we treat it like, I'm going to get people saved. And then we measure that and go, hey, we had 45 people commit their lives to Christ, and we all cheer and all that kind of stuff. And then we just think that growing them to maturity is kind of bonusing. If they get there, that's good.
That's awesome. If you look at Billy Graham's website, I don't care where I found those numbers,
they even confess that of all the different campaigns that they had, and crusades they had, you know, about 1% of those people grew to maturity in Christ. Thousands, millions come into Christ. Now, seeds still planted in many of those people, but about 1% grew to maturity in Christ. Paul said, stay in, stay with it. You see somebody come to know Christ, stay with it. Stay with them until they grow to maturity in Christ. It's great that they came to know Christ, but sometimes we mistake that. I think of Matthew chapter 13. You might write it down real quick, look at it later. That's that parable of the four kinds of soils. Remember that? Remember the hard-packed soil? The seed would go out on this hard-packed soil. And how many of you are farmers? Any farmers here? Okay, stop. Keep pretending. Don't listen right now. But you would know that they came by, you know, the birds came, and what did they do with the seed, right? They ate it all, right? And every farmer gets that. I don't want to waste my seed on the hard-packed soil. I want it to land in the right place. But when the farmer, some will go on the soil, and it will never germinate. And then there's the second soil. Remember the shallow ground? And there's a shallow ground, some places where the soil is kind of good right about here, but then underneath it's all rocky. And so the seed goes in, and what does it do? Germinates, right? Awesome, it grows, and you get excited when you see life. But something's happening. The seed died, and it sprouted up. And then it's blown off, right? It's scorched by the sun. Wade and I were talking about Wisconsin. I remember 90, 100 day corn, right? Knee-high by 4th of July, you know? But I've never seen a farmer when the corn comes up and dies in a week go, well, it was a pretty good start, wasn't it? Did you see that when it first came up, nice and green and amazing stuff? You never see a farmer cheering about all that. No one would say, I know it didn't grow bear fruit, but you should have seen it in the first week, right? You should have seen it. It was pretty awesome. But we do that with people all the time. Who changes a heart? I mean, we're measuring something that only Jesus can do. Yes, present the gospel. But it's God's deal whether or not people are going to come. That's why in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit adds 3,000 people, it was the Spirit's work. They were positioning themselves. They were ready vessels for God. But the work of the church, if you read Ephesians 4:11, right, is to equip people to do the work of ministry. So our job is to come alongside people, get in the messiness, stay on message, have the right perspective, keep your method and your goals straight, but don't confuse a decision and say we're all done. There was the other soil where it was choked off, right, by the worries and of life and then sin and all these other things. And you don't see farmers saying, boy, man, that was such a cool plant until the weeds got a hold of it, right? Let's send a letter out saying we had all these great plants going to all of our co-op supporters, right? They never do that. The weeds are taking over, right? But we tend to, again, do that with people. And then there's the good soil, right? The seed goes deep in there, and what happens? It germinates. It takes root, and it just creates 30, 60, 100 fold. And what happens when a fruit germinates, right? There's more seed in that. And so fruit that bears fruit that will bear more fruit that will bear more fruit. That's God's design for the church. And if we just say, well, we had a crusade, 75 people came to the Christ, we're all good, I think we're missing the point. We're getting off message. We're missing the goal. And sometimes we get stuck there when we try to change people's morality, make them more comfortable, or confuse a decision with a disciple. You see what we're getting here? The fruit of the Spirit is not the number of people you lead to Jesus, because you don't either. It's the fruit of a changed life. The fruit of a changed life. And a changed life will help bring other people to Jesus. And then the last one is this. The right power source. I love that. In verse 29, Paul says, to this end I labor. He is not going to give up. Remember Timothy, he says, Timothy, I'm being poured right out. I'm just poured out like a drink offering. Wherever that's going to go, I'm trusting God to take me there. And he says, I labor struggling with all whose energy in verse 29? All his energy, right? It's all God's energy, not mine, which so powerfully works in me. Remember, you have all the power of the deity in you. Whether it's overcoming struggles in your life or being a ready vessel, it's all there. That person that's trying to make your life miserable and your HOA, it's all there. To love them, to put that person's, yes, that person's need ahead of your own. It's easy to love people that love you. Everybody does that. It's easy to even love people that are in need. Celebrities do that. It's called image consultants, so we can talk about it all the time. But it's really hard to love somebody who has it in for you. Only Christ. Only Christ's power. It's easy. It's hard to love somebody who's in office. And maybe, you know, I found it kind of funny. Someone said, you know, when President Trump was in there, everybody saying, pray for the president. Pray for the president. We need to be on our knees and praying. Yeah, it was wonderful. I did. I prayed for the president. And then Joe Biden gets in. I don't hear anybody saying enough pray for the president anymore.
Pray for the president.
Thank you. We're going to pray for the president. In a minute, we'll do just that. Because loving people that can offer you nothing in return, only Christ. And it's not your power. And here's what I want you to hear about this. Your ministry is not your power. So once you've done everything, once you've gotten the right perspective, once you've gotten the right message, once you've gotten the right goals and method, remember, it's God doing the work. And you've been a ready vessel. You've done the work of abiding in Christ. Here's what I love and I think we need to do. Sit down and take a nap. Relax. You know, just relax, because it's God's work in us. Take a chill pill. It's not up to us. You know, whatever I long to do in God's kingdom, like I have people, I mentioned my sons, that I would love to see come to know Christ. There are people that I've been meeting with for years and still don't get it and want them to understand the truth. There are missions trips we go out on. We'd love to see people come to know Christ. It can get really, really overwhelming. And I know, I've told you before, my journal, the number one word in my journal is overwhelmed. And the problem's not that person that made me overwhelmed, it's me. I remember as a senior pastor in Northern California going to my elder team, I sat down and said, guys, I'm dying here. I'm working 7 days a week. I'm doing all the weddings, bar mitzvahs, and funerals. Not bar mitzvahs, but, you know, we're doing everything.
The circumcision.
We're doing circumcisions on the eighth day, and I'm getting tired of it. I'm just getting done, though, right? But I'm getting tired of trying to get people coming in. People wanted to be with me because I wanted people to like me. I'm still a people pleaser. I still have the Messiah complex in me. A lot of good things happen. But, you know, they say pastors can only reach about 60 people if that's the way they're doing it. So churches, funny, in our county, most of the churches never grew over 60 people. We were the mega church, about 330 people in there, because wow, it was amazing. I was exhausted. I went to our guys, I'm exhausted. And I thought they'd go, wow, well, you're a faithful servant. Why don't you take a sabbatical? I never had a sabbatical, ever in my life. I keep missing out on those things. They said, why don't you stop making it about you? I'm like, oh. Yeah, you know, we're not going to reach everybody in McKinleyville, the town we're in. We're not going to get it all done here. We just need to be faithful, and we need you to get at a pace that's going to allow you to have long-term lasting fruit. Stop trying so hard in your own strength, because the energy is the Lord's. I want to close with that verse in Proverbs 21. You know, the energy is His. We're simply called to live life to the full, right? Live it to the full, John 10:10, right? And go at it with everything you have. But then rest. If you read the book of Hebrews, it's all about how God is our priest, and we're to run on rest, right? Any pilots in here? We got pilots in here, right? There's a term about getting the plane into the air. You burn through most of your fuel getting the plane in the air. But then once you get to the cruising altitude, what do pilots do? They dial back. Cruising altitude, right? It's called running on rest. You're running at as peak efficiency as you can. There are going to be days you get up, you're going to be pouring it out, you're going to be exhausted. But then again, we're designed to rest. If you're not finding rest, so now some of you are finding too much rest, you need to hear a different message. But if you're not finding rest, that's a problem. And so I love what Proverbs 21:30 says. It says, no wisdom, no understanding, no counsel can avail against the Lord. The horse is made ready for the day of battle. And I love this phrase, but the victory belongs to the Lord. There's no power above God. There's a lot of comfort in that verse. It's not up to you. You don't have to be the one getting out with your hair on fire. But if we just voted differently, if we just get out there and campaign, it's like, you know, whatever. God is the one. And it's in Matthew 6:33, right? Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. That's a John 15 kind of reference, right? Be close to the vine. And what does that verse end with? And all these things will be added to you. But don't miss the first part of the verse. Keep the first thing first. Jesus, all the power of the deity is in you. Seek that righteousness, not legalism. be intimate, be close to him, and watch what he can do when we release. We ready the horse, and then we sit back and relax, because the power, the end results are not in our hands. And if you do that, he just asks you to do that to the best that you can. You have kind of a ministry, as we call this, made simple. Whether you have a huge platform of ministry or you're back behind the scenes, that's your calling. And that's been my prayer for us, even at Marketplace, that we would all recognize we have a role to play, a calling God has given us, and that we live it to the full. And then leave it to God. Celebrate fruit when it happens, when we see it, be excited about it, but stay in the game till people are presented mature in Christ. I talked over time, so I'll pray. If you get questions, email them to Skip. Let me pray for us. God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for just the truth of your word. Thank you for Paul. Thank you that he was a man who understood and understood through hardship. Lord, so much hardship that he went through. Christ even gave his life, which is the message of the gospel. Paul too, and all the disciples would give their lives for this cause, for this truth. Help us, God, each one that's here. If there's anybody here that's just struggling, whether it's just the stuff of life, a little depression, a little physical stuff that's going on, maybe financial concerns, maybe kids, as we mentioned with Mark, Dave's son, that we want to pray for him. God, your work in him is not done yet. Your work in Rob Bell is not done yet. Your work in Joe Biden is not done yet. Because you are the God who is in control of all things. And we advocate that to you. Help us when we try to take it back. Help us when we as living sacrifices keep getting up off the altar to stay down and allow your power to move through us. And may you receive all that glory. And may you receive all that to the end of days as we fill out every breath you've given for us. Thank you for this morning. Bless us as we go. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
And then thanks for coming. Hang out. There's donuts. And don't forget to talk to Jeff Simon if you've got a question.
Thanks, Neil.